or something?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, this is the day we collide. Okay. Yes.
No.
Yeah. So. Yeah. So last time, at the end of the lecture, I had a request from a student to spend a little while talking about what on earth Fourier transform was for and why we make such a big deal of it, both in analysis 2 and now. And so I thought I would sort of go off the rails for a little while and spend 10 minutes trying to say some of that. Before we get back to all of the things we're meant to be doing today. We do have a big technical debt, if you remember from Monday. There are lots of things we're meant to prove. So, I'll sort of start with some sort of more sort of prosaic take on it, and then sort of get into what I think is the sort of the real mathematical explanation for why Fourier transform. The basic idea kind of why Fourier transform for non-mathematicians is just that it's about picking out frequency components. When you look at formula, the point is just that if you're say your function is not oscillatory, that is, if it stays basically constant over long intervals, then for values of xi, which are sort of smaller than those long intervals, you expect this interval to be roughly zero, because if f is not changing very much, and then we look at this exponential function, which is cycling round and round and round very fast through here, the integral of the product, of course, will then also be oscillating very, very fast, and you expect that all of the different contributions to the integral to be basically cancelling out. Here, the contribution from this little bit will cancel out that and there and so on. Okay, but obviously that heuristic only works when the function is sort of only varying slowly on those scales. On the other hand, if your function is itself kind of oscillating at some particular frequency, then when you do this exact same thing, then instead all the contributions will match up. I mean, this will match up with that, and this low bit will match up with this lower bit, and you'll get a strong contribution to the integral. So you're basically sort of thinking, I mean, always, that just the value at xi is picking out the sort of frequency xi components of whatever this sort of time oscillating signal is. And so from the point of view of Fourier transform for everything up, like in all the sciences and engineering and so on, it's just this idea. It's picking up frequency. Okay. But this is a pure maths course, and we don't need to care about applications if we don't want to. So what are the applications within mathematics? Well, they turn out to sort of be all over the place, and many of them are sort of just because of this basic feature. But let me just give you an example of something that at first appears to be very, very far from this sort of idea, but yet where Fourier transform is really important. So there's this amazing theorem called the Green Tau theorem. Have any of you guys ever heard of this one?
Is this something to do with, like, number theory?
It's something to do with number theory, and I saw a nod back there. Do you know what this one's about?
No, this is Terry Tau.
This is the Terry, yeah, this is Terry Tau, yep. So the theorem says...
infinitely many n primes or something.
So first of all, Euclid told us there are infinitely many primes, and we all know how to prove that. And then what these guys proved with it is that there are arbitrarily long arithmetic progressions. The primes. So, like, he will say that basically this theorem guarantees, like, if you want a sequence of length 120, the theorem guarantees that you can find some number, maybe it's 20 quadrillion, so that at some point out you'll eventually find 120 primes that are each 20 quadrillion apart. Okay? Does people understand what the statement is at least. So it's an extremely simple statement. You could have told it to Euclid, and he would have known what you were talking about. But the proof is fundamentally using Fourier theory. And somehow, I could not, in 30 seconds, give any attempt at explaining this theorem, but the sort of rough idea is to think of the primes as a sort of random set of integers with a sort of that are there according to some certain distribution. We know that primes get thinner and thinner, but you think of them as a sort of randomly distributed set according to some distribution, and then prove some theorems that say actually for the real primes, sort of they can't be too badly off this sort of random distribution we're thinking about, and then you do Fourier analyses of sort of. Of the frequency components of some random distribution that is a good model for the primes. And this theorem in a really fundamental way uses all the stuff that we're developing. So that's kind of crazy. But it sort of it follows exactly this idea that because sort of is there for frequency components. Now probably in analysis two you guys saw like you solved a bunch of differential equations using Fourier transforms when you saw them the first time or no?
Yeah.
No one's told you guys anything. Okay, so let's solve some differential equations. I'll not attempt to be super rigorous in here. We'll fake a few bits in places. Okay, let's solve this differential equation. You knew how to solve this in high school, so this is a sort of baby example. But let's see a really systematic way to solve it that uses Fourier transforms. So take the Fourier transform on both sides. So I'm going to use hat often for Fourier transform when I don't want to write curly F. And now we talked last time about this idea that differentiation and multiplying by X get interchanged when you take Fourier transform. Remember that there was this idea that F of D of F is X times big F of F, where D here was, I guess, minus E by X. Oh, sorry, minus I E by X. Okay? So we can just use that fact twice here, and we get out minus xi squared f hat of xi equals f hat of xi, or said another way, xi squared plus 1 times f hat of xi equals 0. Okay? So what are the solutions of that equation look like? Well, this is where I'll play a bit fast than this, but to show you this example. I mean, this function mostly doesn't vanish. I mean, it's nearly always non-zero. So for this to be true, this function better be zero everywhere where this doesn't vanish. So you might think, since this only vanishes at, this factor only vanishes at two points, there are just two places where this is allowed to be non-zero. So let's step outside the world of functions and use distributions and say this tells us that f hat of xi is some scalar multiple of a Dirac delta function at either xi equals plus or minus I, the places where that guy vanishes. Okay, and now let's just Fourier transform back again, and we're done. So now use inverse Fourier transform. So of course, f of x equals g of f hat. Xi point x, and that's just this z is just some constant, so we can just ignore that, and then some integral e to the 1 over 2 pi annoying e to the I x xi times this delta function at xi equals plus or minus I, and then we integrate over xi, and integrating something times a Dirac delta function, I mean, by definition, really, that's just evaluating this function at that point. So this is e to the I x plus or minus I. So we discovered that the solutions are exactly scalar multiple. I guess maybe I should have written here like z times this guy plus z prime times the other guy, rather than writing the plus or minus. But well, you can. Everyone sees what's going on there. So we basically see the solutions are linear combinations of the two exponentials, okay? Which we did somehow, well, yeah, it's somehow a sort of systematic argument. So let me show you another one. that I guess maybe we'll come back to, but let's solve the heat equation. So you guys talked about Fourier transforms analysis too, but you did.
No, you didn't.
Yes.
No,
we
yes.
Oh, we didn't.
We literally just proved things about them.
Yeah,
like
convolution to a
product.
And no one ever mentioned differential equations.
Oh no, it was just like here's this neat function that we can prove some nice theorems about.
Who's teaching analysis too?
Brian.
And you.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
There was once 2406 used to do this.
Okay. So here's the heat equation. So U here is some function of two variables. I guess we're going to write
T and X,
time and position. And this is meant to just tell you how heat moves around in a uniform material. Okay, the time derivative of the temperature at some point depends on the second derivative, which is basically saying, like, if you're much hotter than places. Do I need a minus sign there? Surely I need a. No, this is fine. So if you're much hotter than the places around you, the second derivative is negative, so the time derivative is negative. You cool down. Okay, so this is all this equation is saying. But we can just solve this really, really easily now. Let's just again take Fourier transform. So I'll use hat to mean take Fourier transform in the x direction, just ignoring t while you do Fourier transform. And so then, of course, this is just, so let's write in the arguments. So this is still a function of t, but now it's a function of xi. And over here, we get minus xi squared u hat of t xi. Okay. This equation now is really easy to solve. You just think of it as, for each fixed xi, it's a really easy differential equation in t, saying the derivative of the function is some scalar times itself, okay? And so you immediately read off from this that u hat t xi, well, there's some constant, but of course that's u hat 0 xi times, what is it, e to the minus xi squared t. And then just completely systematically, we're just going to apply inverse Fourier transform to go back again. So u of tx is g of u hat t xi at the point x, which, well, now we'll use a theorem that I guess we haven't talked about yet, but Fourier transform and inverse Fourier transform have a beautiful formula when you apply them to the product of two functions. We're going to have to use this shortly, but the point is that this just becomes the convolution of the Fourier transforms of the two individual functions. Okay?
Yes.
Do you guys?
Yeah.
Yes.
You proved that. Excellent. Okay. Great. Okay. So you know what convolution is, and did you ever think about this? What Fourier transform? So what sort of function is this in terms of xi? This is a
Gaussian.
Fourier transforms of Gaussians are
Gaussians.
Okay.
I think that was taught in.
We'll come back and do that formula in a moment, but for now let's just pretend we know that. So what we get here is some garbage out the front here, but of course, what's this garbage? I mean, oh, sorry. Well, that garbage is actually really easy. That's just u of 0 xi. That's just the initial temperature distribution in our material at time 0 convolved with. And you get a Gaussian, but there's some funny constants appear in various ways that I'll just tell you for now. Turns out to be that, I think. And so this basically completely tells you how to write down a solution. If you know the initial distribution of temperatures, to work out the temperature at time t, you just convolve it with, well, this Gaussian function, whose amplitude grows as the square root of t, and whose width grows also with the square root of t. Okay, and that just solves the heat equation for you. Fantastic. So, in some sense, that's what Fourier transforms are for, and magically solve lots of differential equations for you. But let's spend a little bit more on this and sort of understand this a little bit more abstractly. Why, I mean, this is sort of, at the moment it's just a miracle, like, wow, Fourier transforms let you solve ODEs, but we didn't really learn why it lets you solve ODEs. And I want to explain that, because there's a good answer, why this trick just magically works. And so the point of that is this, when you look at the, the sort of the reconstruction formula that says you can get F back as the inverse Fourier transform of the Fourier transform. This is not just doing something stupid. This is telling you something fantastic about your function. Let's just write it out. Okay. So here, what I want you to think of is that, well, this is some integral over R, over Rn. But just think integral to like sums for a moment, okay? Just pretend this is a big summation sign instead. What's this really saying? It's saying this thing here is some big linear combination of exponential functions, okay? I mean, it's an integral rather than a sum or whatever. So, writes f as a linear combo, where in its integral sense, of exponential functions. And what's so good about exponential functions, and in particular, and it tells us how to compute the coefficients in this linear combination, exponential functions are exactly the eigenvectors for translation. Okay? So like if I define TA from let's not even specify which function space, some function space on Rn to itself. So fun here might mean L1 or L2 or smooth or whatever you like. Just by taking the function f to the function, the same function but just translated over by a, shifted over by a. Okay? Does it? Yeah, that makes sense. Taking a function, translating the argument. The exponential functions, these guys, are certainly eigenvectors for this operation. Yeah, if you translate an exponential function, e to the I, what variable are you writing them in? X plus a dot xi is of course just e to the I a dot xi times e to the I x xi, and we think if that's the eigenvalue, so, and this was t a of e to the I x xi. Okay, that's the eigenvalue. That's the eigenvector. Okay, so it's telling us that we can, what the reconstruction formula is telling us is you can take any function, you can write it as a linear combination of eigenvectors for translation. Okay. So why is that at all relevant? Well, basically, constant coefficient ODEs are translation invariant. If I give you some solution of a constant coefficient ordinary differential equation, if you've got some solution, any translation of that solution is also must be a solution. Okay? And so that means that so if you think about it, like the space of solutions to an ODE carries an action of the group of translations, because you can take any solution, you can translate it, and it's still a solution. Okay. Now, whenever you've got some space that's got some group acting on it, you should try and break it up, break that space up into eigenspaces for the elements of that group acting on the space. And that's exactly what Fourier transform is doing. Fourier transform is showing us that I take an arbitrary vector and write it as a linear combination of eigenvectors for the symmetries of the object we're trying to study. I mean, notice here that these e to the ix's were actually simultaneously eigenvectors for every different TA. They have different eigenvalues for each TA, but they're simultaneous eigenvectors for the entire group of translations acting. Okay? So this is the fundamental idea. It's just that you're studying some system, it's got some group action on it, so you want to work out how to decompose the solution, the space you're looking at, the space of solutions in the ODE or something else, into things that are particularly easy to understand relative to that group action. So let me give you one more thing, which is sort of a vast generalization of Fourier transform that we won't really talk about for the rest of the course, but it's just worth seeing sort of an instance of where this comes from. So say G is a locally compact abelian group. And if you don't know what any of those words mean, think Rn. Okay? G hat. Well, I wanted to find this to be the characters of G, which is the same thing as saying the homomorphisms from G to S1. Okay. Another way of saying this. So what I mean, is everyone happy with what I mean by a homomorphism from G to S1 here? Has everyone seen enough of algebra to be happy there? Okay. So another way of saying this is it's the functions, or the S1 valued functions on G, which are eigenvectors for all of the translation operators. If you've got functions on a group, you can translate those functions by a group element just by the same formula, like you just multiply the argument by the group element you're trying to translate by, or add, depending on whether you think it's an additive or multiplicative group, I guess. Okay, so why are these two things the same? I mean, saying it's a homomorphism is just saying FAB is FA times FB. Okay, so maybe I should write sort of the group multiplication, the group operation there, which is probably, you should think of as plus the moving abelian groups. Okay, so I'll write a symbol so it doesn't just look like multiplication. But this is exactly saying that this function is an eigenvector for translation by A. Okay, it's saying that the function value at B translated by A is just some constant, f of a, times the value of the function at b. Okay, so these two things are just the same thing. So the characters become the eigenvectors for all of the translation. Okay. And then, so this is called the Pontryagin dual. I think you have an option whether you make that y or a j, depending on how you believe in transliterating Cyrillic. So you'll see different spellings. Okay, so that's the Pontryagin dual. And then there's an amazing version of Fourier transform that takes us, here I'm just going to write again functions on G to avoid analytic issues that we really should deal with if we were doing this whole general subject properly. We should worry, do I mean L1 functions, L2 functions, Schwarz functions, something else? For now, just some class of functions. Two functions on G hat, the Pontryagin dual, which just takes F, some arbitrary function in our group, not necessarily one of these special ones. And what does it do? It sends it to the function on G hat that takes some xi, that's some character of G, okay? And sends it to the integral over g of f of x, g of x, d mu x, because stuff we haven't managed to talk about, every one of these locally compact abelian groups has a natural measure on it called Ha measure, which just God very kindly gave us at the beginning of the universe, and so there's a sensible way to do integration on locally compact abelian groups. Okay, so this is some gadget that takes a function and produces a new function, okay? And then the amazing theorem, there's also script G going from functions on the Pontryagin dual back to functions on the group. And F, some arbitrary function you get like this, that is you take its Fourier transform to get a function on the Pontryagin dual, and then take the inverse Fourier transform to get back again. And this writes F as a linear combo of eigenvectors for translation. Okay. So this is now some enormously general setup that guarantees you that if you have functions on a group, and these functions might be weird things, like they might not even be complex valued functions, they might be functions valued in some Hilbert space or in some Banach space, or like they might have weird complicated values. Nevertheless, all this theory says as long as the group is nice enough, you can always write your function in this really nice way, as linear combinations of things that you understand exactly how they behave under translation. And so this is sort of just a really general way of dealing with things with group symmetries on them. You take your functions on that maybe depend on some group element and write them this way, and everything becomes easier. And this stuff we did at the beginning about solving ODEs is just sort of the inevitable consequence of this. Okay. Enough. Spend half the lecture on that. We need to actually get through the notes. So maybe I should have said this before I went on my half-hour ramble trying to motivate things for you. I propose making a deal with you, which was that at the moment we've got two things to prove. Well, I guess we've got three things to prove. Four things to prove. These are the things that we had left over from Monday. F maps Schwartz functions to Schwartz functions. G is a two-sided inverse to F. F preserves the norm up to some factors of 2 pi. And then there was this other fact that Schwartz functions are dense in L2 functions on R, and in fact also LQ functions on R. And the deal that I meant to propose to you at the beginning of the lecture was that we'll go through these now and explain how they go, and there's sort of some weird technical details to understand here that are important and interesting. This one, though, is basically, in some sense, the same technical trick as this one. So the deal is that I'll tell you about why Fourier transforms are awesome, but you guys read the notes on this part carefully and make sure you really understand the trick we use in number two to see that you can do it yourself in number three. It's in the notes, but I'm going to skip that, basically. But it's good to do. Okay. So let's just do the things we need to do. So say F Schwartz, we need to look at the Fourier transform and show that that's Schwartz. So we need to show that we take xi to the alpha differentiation with respect to the xi variables to the beta of F hat of xi, that this is bounded. Remember that the condition was exactly that the soup of this gadget for all multi-indexes, alpha and beta, were bounded. Okay, so we need to show that. Okay, so, well, first we need that f hat is C infinity. So we can take those derivatives. Okay, so we need to just think about d by d xi j of f hat, which is the derivative of this integral. And so we just need to think about why we can do this derivative. Well, why can we do this derivative? We want to argue that this is equal to the same thing with the derivative inside the integration sign, because then once we're inside the integration sign, we just need to differentiate this, which is certainly very smooth. There's no problem there. So we just need to justify that this really, the conditions for one of those theorems that let us differentiate under an equal sign apply. And why does that work? F even is Schwartz at the root. Yeah. So in particular, F is bounded. It's L1. And this case is just absolute value 1 everywhere. So I think that just does it. Okay? This thing's smooth and L1 and bounded. So surely that differentiation of an integral theorem applies. Okay. okay. So then we need to go back and look at this guy. So how do we do that? Well, we look at this guy and use the fact that we can pull derivatives and multiplication by coordinates through the Fourier transform. So this just becomes, we need a big hat now, dx alpha x to the beta, f of x. Okay? And we're meant to, this is the thing that we're meant to be showing is in L infinity. Now, it's a little bit annoying that I didn't end that way. So this is of course some giant integral. And we want to bound that. We're trying to bound that in terms of the psi variable. Okay? So we're interested really in that. The absolute values of these guys. And so let's just move the absolute values inside and then just get rid of this exponential term because it's norm 1. Okay? So all we're trying to do is show that for any given alpha and beta you like, this is bounded. Okay? So I really want this argument is much easier if I have the derivatives, these guys in the other order. And it's a bit awkward to switch them at this point.
You've shown that that's what all not memory challenge.
Yeah, so
not just f, but the x alpha, x to the beta.
Yes, so this thing is itself just some Schwarz function again. Yeah, so actually, so that's a lovely way to do it. Great, thank you. Okay, so so let's just take g to be this guy. Thank you. Yep, that's exactly what I was looking for. which is in the Schwarz functions again. And so all that we need to do is just, so we need to just see that every Schwarz function is actually in L1, okay? That all that remains. So if we know that every Schwarz function is in L1, this guy's Schwarz, so this integral conversion is something finite, and we get the upper bound there. Okay, so why does this work? Well, if you've got some Schwarz function, what we know is that eventually it's smaller than any polynomial, so we can just say, if we've got some f in the Schwarz functions, we can say that f is less than some constant times 1 over any polynomial we want, okay? And so we can take this is just some polynomial in x, in all of the x coordinates together. So we can assume our Schwarz function is less than 1 over it, up to some constant, and then this is in L1, okay? Okay, great. So we've got okay, so now we're meant to check that curly f and curly g are inverses of each other, at least on the Schwarz functions. And so the idea here is that we just want to do the integral, and we just want to say we've got phi a Schwarz function, and g of f of phi at the point x, let's just write out the giant integral, it's 1 over 2 pi n, this integral that comes from doing the inverse Fourier transform of the integral that comes from doing the Fourier transform. Where I just changed the variable of integration on the inner variable to x, just so it didn't collide with this x out. Okay. Now, and this is also an integral over R. So what would we like to do here? We'd like to use Fubini and think of this as an integral over r to the 2n, as we do both of these integrations simultaneously, because then these exponentials come together and we can get something out of them. Maybe we should, it might actually be clearest if we fake the proof and pretend we can use Fubini first and just see everything works magically, and then we'll go back and be more careful, because Fubini doesn't work here, and so we really have to use a new trick. So let's pretend. This is not a step in the official proof, but it's helpful still, I think, to help us see what's going on. It's e to the I x minus y dot xi phi of y, and then yeah, actually, no, maybe this isn't going to help to pretend. Yeah, okay, maybe pretending wasn't actually helpful. I mean, if you just change the order of integration, then you just come to this guy and try and do the xi integral here, which is a disaster, yeah? Because this is just some oscillating function. The integrals are never going to converge. Okay, so that was a bad idea. So let's back up. Not do that, but you can also see, maybe I should have left it, you can also see why you can't use Fubini, just because in the xi direction, this is the function isn't decaying at all. It just stays norm one as a, so it stays as whatever the phi is, but basically constant norm as xi goes out to infinity. So the first claim we need is that this is equal to the limit as epsilon goes to zero of following guy, where we put in this extra factor here. Think about what's going on here. So this is some Gaussian term that we put in here, but it, as epsilon goes to zero, it's some extremely broad Gaussian, so it's basically becoming like the function one. So heuristically, at least, it may be believable that this limit as epsilon goes to zero really is what we started with, because this function is pointwise going to one. Okay, let's see if we can work out why that limit works. Well, we're taking some limit of integrals and hoping that it's the integral of the pointwise limit. So we don't have very many options out there. We have to use monotone or bounded or dominated convergence to possibly get there. What are we going to do? And we know these integrals all exist and work fine. And the point is here is that this is always bounded by one. I mean, a Gaussian function is actually less than one everywhere, and converges pointwise to one. And so, just sort of treating this bit as a black box, you can just use the dominated convergence theorem to see that sort of this outer integral here, we're using the dominated convergence theorem with respect to this limit and this integral, this part in here is just coming along to the right. And while we're doing this argument, you just think of that whole bit as phi hat psi, okay? And the point is just that this integrand here is integrable. I mean, we know this integral exists, and the integral is always, the thing we're actually integrating here is always less than the thing we're integrating on. So that works fine, and now we, so now things are going to work, is the point. We will be able to use for the, so this trick is a sort of baby example of what you might call mollification. It's taking this integrand that behaves badly in one direction, and it's sort of tamping it down by multiplying in this Gaussian function that now vanishes in infinity, and that gets rid of that bad oscillatory behavior in the direction that we actually want to integrate first. Okay, so what happens after that? Well, now we can use for B. No one actually ever checks that you can use for B except when they get it wrong, but I'll tell you guys to check it. Okay, and what happens? So the thing we're after now becomes it's 1 over 2 pi the n. Now we're going to do the integral over dy first. We'll do the innermost integral will be the xi integral. And so what's the stuff that only depends on y? That's the stuff we can pull out the front, just phi of y. But everything else is just some exponential. So the exponential we have remaining is e to the I x minus y dot xi times, maybe Do I want to leave one of them out? Yeah, because no, sorry, I want to leave them all. Sorry. Okay. So, well, the point is that this whole piece here now is exactly just the Fourier transform of e to the where is it? It's a bit confusing because we have to decide whether we're going to call this a Fourier transform or an inverse Fourier transform. It sort of doesn't matter. I'm going to call it a Fourier transform, even though the integration variable is xi, which is sort of asked backwards and is a bit confusing, but I think it's okay. But it's evaluated at the point y minus x. Okay? Usually, like the point, the argument of the Fourier transform would be the thing that comes here. Okay? And so since there's meant to be a minus sign there, we better have a y minus x. Okay. So now we need a little bit of an aside on Fourier transforms of Gaussians. So how do you do Fourier transforms of Gaussians? So let's just calculate the Fourier transform of e to the minus ax squared over 2. Okay. So the nice thing here is that, that's right, what I've done in the notes is u of x is that guy. Okay. Now, the way we're going to deal with this guy is that differentiating this guy is nice and easy. It just pulls out a factor of x, and then we can use the fact that Fourier transform plays well with multiplication by polynomials. And so, said another way, we could differentiate this, and that would let us. So that's I times d f of this guy. And now that lets us pull we can pull that d in to get x times e to the ax squared over 2 xi. But now we can just rewrite that. This is like we took the derivative with respect to x of e to the minus ax squared over 2, but I guess we need an extra factor here. What factor would come out here? It would still be a factor of, I guess, minus a that's still there, so we need minus 1 over a. Just want to check that I did that right. Confirm that the derivatives are correct. Yell out if not. And now I'm just going to pull the derivative back out again. and get that this is, let's see. Hopefully it's minus over a f of, I feel like this a is wrong. Okay. It's right.
Do you need a 2 as well?
I don't need the 2 because when you derivate the x squared, you get a 2x. Yeah. And that half. So have I done something wrong here? Xi over here.
Where'd that go?
Yeah.
Okay.
I stopped writing it. Yeah.
No.
Yeah. People are unfortunately a bit inconsistent about that. And also, this X should have been Xi all along, because U is a function of Xi. Ugh. So that pulls out as Xi. But here it's still meant to be x's, yeah, because this thing we're taking the Fourier transform with some function of the x coordinates. Okay, maybe that's right actually. And then a little bit. Oh, I see. I've just not actually followed what I was doing in the notes. In the notes, yeah, I had let u be this guy. Oh, yeah, that would have been so much clearer. Okay, this is the right formula, but now we can just see how it works. It's saying whatever u is, its derivative is just basically x times itself, and we know how to solve that differential equation. That tells us that u looks like some constant, which we can determine later, times e to the some other constant, which we can work out from looking at this. Times, so let me write u of xi. Xi squared. Okay? And this d must be just that number there, but presumably with an extra factor of 2 somewhere to cancel this 2, xi over 2a. And I think that derivative works. And you now still have to work out what this constant is by working out what u of 0 is, which is plugging in xi of 0 here and just doing that integral. And we get something. Sorry, I botched that so horrifically badly. The formula that we're after at the end of the day is that the Fourier transform of e to the minus ax squared over 2 is this guy. So you might wonder, how did this 2 pi show up here? The normal Fourier transform doesn't have a 2 pi in it. So where did that come from? Remember where it comes from?
Maybe like polar coordinates or something. When you
polar coordinates or something, yeah, yeah. The point is, in calculating this c, we needed to know what u of 0 was. So u of 0 was this Fourier transform at xi equals 0. So this exponential term becomes irrelevant because it's got a 0 in it. And then we're just integrating that function. Okay? And then you do that trick in polar coordinates to do these. You change. You do that trick in polar coordinates to do that. Hopefully you guys. I mean, this is a very standard integral, and it gets some facts that you like. Okay, so I guess we're going to have to pause there because we've run out of time, and I didn't finish the proof because I'm incredibly lame. But yeah, so we'll try and resume from this point midway through a proof on graphs. Two questions. Yes.
Yes. Just to check what I'm saying, Scott.
Yeah.
On the side at the bottom, that's like psi on 2a. Psi squared.
That's complete rubbish. The xi just didn't need to be there, did it?
Yeah. Okay, cool.
1 over 2a.
Nice.
Good. That's much better. Yep.
So our limit that we had with epsilon is that we're now sort of thinking of that inside the first integral.
Yes, so the point is that this equals this limit.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, and so I should have this formula said of g of f of v equals the limit as epsilon goes to 0 of this.
Okay.
So we're going to work on this integral for a while, and we'll finally take its limit again at the end once we've simplified the whole thing.
So much more like that.